Hello and welcome to Classic Judging by the Cover, the series that's more stuck in the past than a partially ejected miscarriage. Oh Christ. Where we'll be judging Tomb Raider. As in all of them. All of them up to 2003 anyway, which was when the publishers took the franchise away from Core Design and gave it to someone else. Which was perfectly understandable. I mean, if you knew that your next-door neighbours had hooked up their own children to industrial milking machines, you'd probably have called up Child Protection Services as well. But let's start at the start with Tomb Raider 1. This was the first time Lara Croft appeared in anything, and yet they still put a big fat featuring Lara Croft along the bottom. The overt assumption being that we will have already become invested in this character on the strength of this image alone. Or perhaps I should say, the strength of the fabric that her top is made out of. Look at her. If she swallowed a coin, you could read the year on it all the way down to her bumhole. In any case, I'm not sure how I'm supposed to get invested in her from this image of what is clearly a botched shoplifting attempt. After jamming two mixing bowls down her shirt and gluing a box of Terry's All Gold chocolates to the front of her pants, she thought she'd made it to the car park of the Kmart, but then a spotlight turned on and the siren started to wail, and she realised it was time to enact Plan B. I don't want to get bogged down on fine details here, because we've got a lot of stuff to get through, but her mouth, eyes and eyebrows do totally look like they came from a box of fuzzy felt. So let's move on to Tomb Raider 2. By which time Lara finally got over her gun phobia and stopped holding them at arm's length like she's about to start exaggerating her fishing accomplishments. Hey, wait a minute. Why was her left arm so much skinnier than her right there? I guess now we know how Lara spends those lonely nights in the murder temple. As you can see, her status has been upgraded from featuring to starring. But what we gain on the swings, we lose on the roundabouts, so Fuzzy Felt Features is now somehow even less detailed. They didn't even put the little creasy bits around her jugs. How am I supposed to delude myself that this is a real woman as I rub my nasty little teenage cock? I mean, she's got one tit nestled in the crook of her arm. So if she straightens that arm too quick, then that tit's gonna catapult into her face and give her a concussion. Indeed, we see that by Tomb Raider 3, Lara is really starting to feel the effect of a lifetime's improper tit management, as she's now bent forward with crippling scoliosis. Even now, she hasn't learned to employ proper support and continues to wear vests made of sticky-backed plastic. But what is life if not a series of lessons learned? Lara is at this very moment learning why you don't wear sunglasses at night, because you have to look over them to see anything. And then you notice that while you were stumbling around blind, some joker stuffed a flowering dandelion down your gun, because we don't know what muzzle flashes look like. If that's supposed to be St. Paul's Cathedral in the background, then Lara is hovering about 50 feet in the air. That's the kind of comical misunderstanding that happens when your breast implant surgeon is roommates with a helium balloon salesman. Except it can't be a full-size St. Paul's, because Lara's casting a shadow upon it. Lara learned nothing from the shoplifting adventure. Now she's taken to sneaking around Legoland at the dead of night. Oh man, they forgot to put the main character's name on the front of this one. Now we won't know if we're playing Lara Croft or her tearaway sister Mildred. Well, if it is Lara, she's on the road to recovering from her scoliosis problem at least. Probably because she wears a shirt made of actual fabric that wasn't just painted onto her tits. And look! Her hands no longer look like tiny fragile clusters of lolly sticks wrapped around an oversized gun, and her head no longer looks big enough to put the entire rest of her body in if you scrunched it up a bit. It's almost like they're trying to make her look halfway like a real woman. A real woman with thighs thicker than her waist and jugs like sumo wrestlers fighting in a bin liner. Whoops, we're back to the sunglasses problem, aren't we? Of course you're going to have to look over them to see your way around these weird indistinct smears that look like the blue meanie wiped his ass on the jewel case. You know what, this one's shit, let's look at the American box art instead. Yeah, that's more fucking like it, bitches. Blue meanie tries wiping his ass on us, we don't take that shit. We fucking hurl our face towards the nearest plate glass window. I don't see how Lara could possibly have known what she was going to be shooting at the start of the kind of run-up necessary to get through reinforced glass, but who cares? I'm finally excited to see what the future holds. Oh, Apparently it holds going back to standing around like a fucking gormless twat. Surrounded now by indistinct blue smears, so I guess we just got done crawling all the way through the blue meanie's large intestine. But in many ways, this is the perfect ending for Tomb Raider's first generation. See how Lara bookends the series by once again standing holding her guns like there's something nasty on them both. But see also the myriad of lessons she has learned on the way. She's learned that giant golden cuboids aren't very good belt buckles. Neither, of course, are miniature CRT televisions, but cut her some slack, it's progress. And she's learned that she can wear tops that aren't uniform minty green. Soon, she'll learn that black, while a much more practical colour, is a hell of a lot worse at hiding toothpaste stains.